Thanks, Luke. Thanks so much for inviting me to speak here today and for organizing this extremely important event. And for the opportunity to speak as part of this very, very distinguished panel and to a very distinguished audience. By being here on a Sunday morning, you've proven yourselves to be among the most committed and determined supporters of Israel. So thank you all for being here, and it's a real opportunity and an honor for me to be able to speak to all of you. I want to speak about the legacy of the Balfour Declaration and the responsibility that I think that legacy gives us as British supporters of Israel. And I believe that the Balfour Declaration and its legacy gives us two responsibilities. First is the responsibility to tell people here in the UK why the Balfour Declaration and international recognition of the right of the Jewish right to a national home matters so much to Jews. And the second responsibility is to do our part to ensure that the Jewish national home, which is expressed today as the State of Israel, today and in the future, reflects the spirit of that important clause of the Balfour Declaration, which affirms the civil rights of non-Jews. And as someone who lives in Israel, and I made Aliyah 10 years ago, and as someone raising children in Israel, I think it's particularly important to speak about this also. But first of all, that first responsibility, to tell people why the Jewish national home is so important to the Jewish people. And as supporters of Israel, there are three messages which I think can help explain this. The first message is that the Balfour Declaration reflected a recognition that there ought to be a place in the world where the Jewish people can live free from the oppression of others. And this came with the recognition that the Jews had suffered from centuries of homelessness and persecution. And you heard from Lord Turnbull those extraordinary quotes from Lord Balfour himself about that realization. And we need to tell people that this recognition was consistent with the principle that would come to be recognized as the universal right of all peoples to their national self-determination. The second message is that what is crucial about the Balfour Declaration is not just that it affirmed the idea of a Jewish national home, but with the endorsement of the League of Nations, it laid the basis for that to become a legal and a physical reality. And hundreds of thousands of Jews owe their lives to that. Around 250,000 Jews fled to Palestine from Nazi persecution in the 1930s. And those that were left behind perished in their millions. And for many of us, this is a personal story. In my own case, my wife's maternal grandparents fled Poland to Palestine in the mid-1930s. Had it not been for the Balfour Declaration, there may well have been no Jewish national home for them to flee to. My wife and my kids would not be here today. And that is the story of hundreds of thousands of Jews in Israel and around the world. So when I hear people calling for an apology for the Balfour Declaration, I want to ask them, are the people alive today, because of the Balfour Declaration, supposed to apologize that they and their parents and their grandparents survived? We know, of course, the Jewish people will never apologize for their survival. The third message is that the Jewish national home is important because it made possible the establishment of Israel as the nation state of the Jewish people. The Jewish state, after its establishment, gave a home to hundreds of thousands of refugees who had survived the Holocaust and hundreds of thousands more who faced persecution in Islamic countries and other places around the world. It made possible the rebirth and rejuvenation of the Jewish people and the Jewish national spirit. And this matters not only to Jews in Israel, but Jews everywhere. As Lord Sachs has written, because of the existence of the State of Israel, Jews, wherever they are in the world, can speak on equal terms. No longer need they be haunted by the trauma of homelessness. So these are the three messages that we need to tell people about why we celebrate the Balfour Declaration. Because it recognized the right of the Jewish people to a national home. Because it provided physical refuge to hundreds of thousands of Jews and because it laid the basis for the state of Israel and the rejuvenation of the Jewish people. And for these three reasons, the Balfour Declaration is an indispensable chapter in the Jewish narrative of salvation. And it's no wonder, therefore, that according to a recent survey, this is data similar to that you heard from Gillian, 90% of British Jews support Israel's right to exist as a Jewish state, and 93% say it forms some part of their identity as Jews. So anybody who denies the right of the Jewish people to their national home must either be completely ignorant of Jewish history, or have no care at all for the welfare of the Jewish people or for the feelings of Jews here in the UK. Those who want to get rid of Israel today realise they cannot do it by force. So they're trying to take away the legitimacy of the idea. And that is why you, as activists, supporting Israel in the UK, are on the front lines in one of the most crucial battles in Israel's history. So every letter you send, every meeting you attend, and every stall that you man matters to the state of Israel. So I've spoken about the need to tell people about why the Jewish national home matters and to defend it against those who wish to undermine it. And now I want to turn to the importance of fulfilling the spirit of that important clause of the Balfour Declaration, which makes a commitment to the civil rights of non-Jews. Today I think that means two things. It means firstly ensuring the rights of non-Jewish citizens of the state of Israel. And secondly, it means ensuring that Palestinians who are not citizens of Israel also have a national home through a two-state solution. Now, thinking about the status of non-Jews in the state of Israel today, there is a lot to be proud of. And I want to share with you some personal experiences, since, as I say, I've been living in Israel for 10 years now. I research and teach at the Hebrew University in Jerusalem. In fact, my office overlooks the auditorium, the amphitheatre, where Lord Balfour himself was the guest of honour at the founding ceremony of the university in 1925. This year I taught politics undergraduates at the Hebrew University, a course on the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. And in my class in Jerusalem, I have Jewish students and Arab students studying the Israeli-Palestinian conflict side by side. And the fact that Jews and Arabs can study the Israeli-Palestinian conflict side by side in Jerusalem, I can hear one another's perspectives in an atmosphere of respect and tolerance, only shows the utter absurdity of the shameful attempts by BDS activists here in the UK to prevent Israeli voices being heard on university campuses. My wife is a lecturer at Haifa University, and a third of her students are Arab citizens of Israel, as, by the way, is the dean of her faculty, her boss. This represents the best of Israeli society: pluralistic, open and welcoming to non-Jewish minorities. And these examples reflect the most optimistic visions that Balfour and his colleagues could have dreamed of when they spoke about a Jewish national home in which the civil rights of non-Jews would not be prejudiced. Now, there are clearly unacceptable economic gaps between Jews and Arabs in Israel, but many trends there are also positive. The gaps are beginning to narrow, and last year the Israeli government took a landmark decision to invest billions of shekels bringing services in Arab districts up to the levels of the rest of the country. But having said that, we cannot ignore the fact that other trends in Israel are negative and do not reflect the spirit of the Balfour Declaration. And I want to quote Israel's president, Ruvi Rivlin, who has spoken repeatedly about the dangers facing Israeli society. At a conference in 2015, he said, "There is a crisis on the right. It sees the Jewish and democratic state as a democracy for the Jews. This is something I cannot countenance." And just a few days ago, in an important speech to the Herzliya conference, which is a big annual policy conference in Israel, he warned again, "There will be no Jewish state if there is no democratic state." And what the president is talking about is a populist and sometimes racist and sometimes xenophobic trend on parts of the Israeli right which seeks to divide Israeli society. Now, I just spent a week in Brussels speaking to politicians and diplomats from all over Europe. And in every country in Europe, including here in the UK, we see populist politicians taking advantage of people's sense of insecurity and people's sense of threatened identity to divide communities. That sense of us versus them helps them politically. So they do everything they can to promote division rather than heal division. I'm afraid to say Israel is not immune to this. And in some ways it's particularly vulnerable because we are still in an unresolved national struggle and because we face very real security threats. And the incitement, I'm afraid, from parts of the Israeli right is not just against Arabs. We're seeing incitement against all those who speak up for the principles of equal rights in Israel, whether that is politicians on the left, or the courts, or the media, or even sometimes the president of the state. This is against the spirit of the Balfour Declaration. But more importantly, it's against the spirit of the founders of the Zionist movement, going back to Theodor Herzl. So if we want to honour the legacy of the Balfour Declaration as supporters of Israel, we must send a clear message of support to those Israelis, like President Rivlin, calling for a more open, tolerant, and pluralistic Israeli society. At the same time, we must also be very clear on the Palestinian national question. Israeli politicians from across the political spectrum, including Prime Minister Netanyahu, have recognized that if Israel does not end its control over the Palestinians, it risks becoming no longer a Jewish state, but a binational state. Those are the words of Prime Minister Netanyahu. Resolving the conflict, as we all know, is not something Israel can do alone. A majority of Israelis support a two-state solution. The Palestinians have repeatedly squandered opportunities for peace. But there are politicians in the current Israeli government who are doing all they can to make a two-state solution impossible. They are unconcerned about millions of Palestinians living under Israeli control without civil rights. And this too is against the spirit of the Balfour Declaration. Our Jewish claim to the right to self-determination is based on the principle that the right to self-determination is due to all people. Therefore, it must also be due to the Palestinians in the framework of a two-state solution. And so to truly honour the Balfour Declaration, we must pursue two missions at the same time. To stand up and say no to the anti-Zionists who question the right of the Jews to their national home, but at the same time to say no to the politics of fear and division in Israeli society and the politics of unending control over the Palestinians. You are the most committed supporters of Israel. You are the people who go to conferences, who give out leaflets, who write letters for Israel. And as supporters of Israel, you are the people who experience the anti-Zionist and sometimes downright anti-Semitic BDS campaign on the front lines. You're the ones who have to stand up to the daily torrent of hatred and lies about Israel. And this gives you the right to have your voice heard by Israeli society and by Israel's leaders. And the way to be heard is to engage directly with the Israeli government and with Israeli society, to speak directly with Israel's representatives, including here in the UK, to speak up in support of President Rivlin, to ally with and support individuals and groups and organisations in the Israeli mainstream who want to make Israel a more democratic and tolerant society. There are some outstanding organisations in the UK doing this kind of work. The UK Task Force on Issues Relating to Arab Citizens of Israel is one outstanding example, and those kinds of projects deserve your support. Being advocates for equal rights in Israel makes us more persuasive advocates for the rights of Israel as the nation state of the Jewish people. And being advocates for Israel as the nation state of the Jewish people makes us more persuasive advocates for equal rights in Israel. We need to remember the Jewish national home was not created by the Balfour Declaration, and not even by the League of Nations mandate. Those were just pieces of paper which created the opportunity. The Jewish national home was created by the Jewish people with the help and blessing of many non-Jewish friends who took action to seize that opportunity And so too today. No outside force, not the British government, not the EU, certainly not Donald Trump, will safeguard Israel's future. The only ones who can safeguard Israel's future, its international legitimacy as the Jewish national home and its democratic character, are the Jewish people and their supporters. We are the ones who can do that, and we must.